let us take this as a serpent. And we can imagine a string around the serpent. We have to unwind the string and allow that endpoint of the string to trace a line. And we know that this part of this end of the string will trace a shape, which is that of an involute. This therefore now outlines to us the shape of the gear teeth, the gear tooth of an involute gear. So this circle, in the terms of involute gears, I repeat, referred to as base circle. Now, if we have a base circle here, we can have another base circle of another gear, which is to be in contact with this gear. So there has to be another kind of an involute shape as we unwind the imaginary string around this base gear. So we can just draw that line and have that particular shape of the gear teeth. We can now draw this line perpendicularly between the line of centers and draw this perpendicular line. And this gear, or this angle, is called the pressure angle. Yes. Pressure angle. And we can easily say that this is equal to the theta, and this is also equal to theta, the pressure angle. And by the way, this circle is now our pitch circle. Same way of the, as that we can have the pitch circle here. So this line here that is tangent to the base circle defines to us our line of action. The line of action. Now, with this, we can determine now our path of contact. So circular pitch is pi d over the number of teeth. And the normal pitch is equal to the circular pitch multiplied by the cosine theta. And we remember the cosine theta is the pressure angle. Again, we can draw this. Two base circles. And let's draw the line of action. And the line of centers, and we can now draw this perpendicular line, and again this is our pressure angle, and that point at which this line of action is tangent to the base circle defines to us also again the same theta, and also here the same theta. So if we have now our base circle, and we remember our pitch circle, we also have to determine our addendum circle. Now there is a limit to this addendum. It can be any value here, but with regard to involute gears, it can be any diameter, but it must not go beyond this point at which the line of action intersects or is tangent to the base circle. And also here, the addendum of the circle must not be beyond that point. That point, by the way, is called the point of interference. So again, this is the point of interference, and this is another point of interference. Now, we have identified a line segment. So that line segment is now the path of contact. So that whole length at which the two gears must be in contact is known as the path of contact. And it is defined or it is determined by our addendum circle of one gear and another addendum circle of the other gear. So we cannot proceed with the other discussion. Let me erase this. With the involute gears, there is such thing as contact ratio. And contact ratio is just equal to the length of the path of contact over normal pitch. Length of the path of contact over the normal pitch. And for the operation of gears, of involute gears, it must be less than or equal to 1. So how do we determine that? We have the path of contact here. We can determine it graphically, or we can have mathematical derivations to be able to determine this length of the path of contact. And we have the normal pitch just equal to the circular pitch times cosine theta. So with that, we can easily make this calculation. Ideally, gears can operate when the contact ratio is equal to 1. But in operation, it is advisable to have a contact ratio equal to 1.6.